Good evening, students. Good evening, listeners. Thank you very much for having me this evening. This is the first radio lecture for this semester when it comes to UDC 111, the School Curriculum, Social Change and National Development. And this evening's lecture will be centered around the topic Types of Education. I'm in the studios this evening with my colleague and myself, Stephen Kwachiapu, all from the Department of Educational Foundations. In this evening's presentation, we will teach for about 30 minutes, that is from 5 o'clock to 5:30 to 6 p.m. Then we will activate the phone lines and other social media platforms for students to phone in with their questions, their comments, and then their contributions to the discussion. Then we will run up by 7 p.m. and then we take our seat back to our homes. The phone number still remains 0503-923158, 0503-923158, 0332-0332-3202-01. The WhatsApp and the text line 0503-923158. As I indicated earlier, I'm in the studios with a colleague to help me do this very discussion. Her name is Miss Miriam Oga. This evening, the two of us are going to talk about types of education. However, it is very prudent for us to start the discussion from the meaning of education before we now zoom in to look at the types of education that we have. We will try as much as possible to give specific relevant examples that will help you to understand the discourse this evening. And so, education. Wherever you go, people are talking about education. But one thing that we have to bear in mind as students is that education remains one of the sociological constructs that defies a specific definition. Education remains one of the constructs that defies specific definition. And so various authors try to define the term from their own angle of disposition, or they define the term to suit their argument and to suit the kind of context that they find themselves. Having said that, it is pertinent that we therefore trace education from its Latin root, and then we will take it from there. Look at the definitions that have been given by other scholars. And lastly, we will talk about the types of education and look at their characteristics before we bring the lecture to a close. And so education. Miss Miriam Oga, we've heard the word on countless times. The moment you hear education, what comes to your mind?
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Appel. Education goes beyond what some people see it to be. Before we delve much into the part, we have to clear the airways that usually whenever the term education comes under review, people erroneously try to equate it to schooling. And so it is important that we make our cherished listeners and students know that education or schooling is just one aspect of education. So like you rightly said, that let's try to trace the meaning of the word from its Latin root, to train. And our listeners will bear with us that training goes beyond schooling, because of course, before we even step school, you even step your feet in school, you ought to have received some form of education from the home. And so, yes, schooling is different from, it's just an aspect of education. Of course, schools are also established to train. So here, education will mean a kind of purposeful activity that is aimed at training an individual to live a productive life.
Good. So a form of activity that is geared towards helping an individual to live a productive life, a productive life in the society. Now let me take you back a little to the Latin origins of the word education. We are saying that according to scholars, education, the first school of thought, that is Scofield, says that education comes from the Latin word educere, E-D-U-C-E-R-E, which means to lead out, to lead out. How I understand this term is that when students come to the classroom, they are within. Most of us come to the school without necessarily knowing the reason why we are even in the school.
Sure.
I quite remember yesterday I asked a student in the class, why is he in school? And he said he's here to be trained to go and get a job and get money. Then I said that then you are the wrong place, because education trains people just for two purposes. To help you to go, and one, help to improve the society you are coming from. So we have the innovative function of education and the other functions which all students are expected to go and then help to improve in the society.
Sure.
And so educere simply means that to lead out. As you said, you may have a talent, but if you don't receive the right education, you will not even recognize the kind of talent that you have. And so most of us, ideally, we shouldn't have been here. But it is the kind of education that we received that brought us here. Again, craft says that it comes from the Latin word educare, which means to form or to train. The same way that when we are forming human beings, or we are forming an object, we bring various components together.
I wanted to find out whether you form a human being before.
I'm relating it to the biblical context.
Okay.
So God has to bring various parts together
before
he could create human being. The same way, when students come to school, they are expected to be formed. In terms of your attitude, in terms of your outlook, in terms of how you even see the world, has to what? Change. And so the formation of the individual, as far as education is concerned, and I like the word that you use, we shouldn't think that the moment you find yourself in school, then there is a formation. You find yourself in school, but education has to pass through you, and it has to pass through education. If not, the formation, because we should understand that you can have an education that may be negative. Though it is expected that all forms of education becomes positive, some end up becoming what? Negative. Even though that is not the focus of curriculum planners and other stakeholders in education. The other thing is that Kraft says it is either to form or to train. To form or to train. And this is where the discipline aspect, your attitude, your skill, and everything comes in.
Sure.
What our learners have to understand is that when they find themselves in any educational enterprise, that enterprise is geared towards bringing them up, shaping their individual talent, and developing their inner potentialities. Having said that, we will look at a few of the definitions and then we will try to talk about them. Agarwal says education is what each generation purposefully passes on to those who are to be their successors in order to prepare them to deal with one another and their surroundings purposefully. Education, I repeat, is what each generation purposefully passes on to those who are to be their successors in order to prepare them to deal with one another and their surroundings purposefully. Miss Miriam, how do you explain this statement to us?
To some extent, I agree with Agarwal. You know, every parent has an expectation for his or her children. And so there are certain things that those who kind of have interaction with their parents very well, or their guardians or their mentors, you realize that every parent would want to see the his or her child go beyond what he or she have achieved in life. So connecting this to education, if we are saying that education goes beyond schooling. Schooling just being an aspect of education. Then, of course, whatever training, and so you go to certain homes and the parents will be like, no, in our home, ladies don't wear trousers. It's a kind of education. They are trying to pass it on to the generation. We do not do this. We do not do that. It's a form of things that, should we call it values, that that particular family or lineage want to preserve. They try to pass it on to their successive generation. And it is a form of training. It is a form of education that they're trying to give. So this is what Agarwal is saying. Yeah, so today I'm let's say a petty trader operating, for instance, a tabletop kiosk. So yes, I would want my children to go beyond this. So the necessary things they want to put in place so that they will see their children climb higher, they will try to do it. So they receive that from there, and in addition to that, when they come to school, let me give you a critical example. I had an interaction with one of the elderly women in society, not here, not in Winneba here. And she said when her daughter got to level 300, she made her stop, and then she bought some forms for her. She gained admission to one of the security services, I think police or so. And the lady stopped and went. She continued. I was like, wow. Then the mother continued. You see, permit me to use the local dialect. She has built houses and lecturers and doctors and co are renting. So to her, whatever schooling is trying to inculcate in the younger ones, she has never stepped foot in the classroom before. She has been able to do this and that. So she feels that the job is the most important thing. That is a legacy that she has led for her children. So they found, why should I go to school before I become successful? That is it. So whatever value that a family value that a family wants to pass on, they try to use it as a form of education, as a form of training, and they pass it down from each generation to from one generation to the other.
Good. So like I said earlier, we have the preservative function of education, where education tries as much as possible to preserve those cultural values that a society thinks they are very essential for the survival of humanity.
Yeah.
That is one. We're looking at another definition by Castle, and I like it so much because it will help us to help our learners to understand that education is not just coming to school.
School. Mm.
He says that education is what happens to a person from the day they are born to the day they die. From the day you are born to the day you die, whatever you go through is what? Education.
Cradle to grave affairs.
Good. So you don't necessarily have to be in school before you become educated.
Of course.
The moment you come to school, then we are talking about a former type of which we will deal with in subsequent
minutes.
But we have to understand that as far as education is concerned, everything you go through is education, according to custom. Mm. So let's assume that yesterday in the morning it rained. Yesterday in the morning it rained. And then, assuming you were on your way walking for lectures and the rain started, you didn't pick an umbrella. By the time you got to the lecture hall, you would have been wet.
Yes.
The next time when you want to walk, something will prompt you that pick an umbrella. There has been what? Education. A lesson has been learned.
Of course.
So education itself is not just about sitting in the classroom, a teacher lecturing you, but rather, from Castle's definition, we have to understand that everything that we go through in life is
education. A form of education.
It's education.
That is why we often hear experience is the best teacher.
Yes.
So whatever you experience, So if, like Castle said, from the time you were born, and there are so many things that a learner or a child, a baby learns as soon as he or she is born. For instance, nobody teaches that baby how to suck. But as soon as the breast is in the mouth, the baby begins to. So right from the beginning, the baby tries to receive some form of education from there. Nobody tells the baby that when your diaper is so wet or when you feel feverish, you should cry. But you cry and then it communicates. So right from birth, there is a form of education through to one passes on.
Good. Having said that, it is important for now to put education in a better perspective. That education brings about learning.
Yeah.
Education leads to the acquisition of knowledge, skill, value, attitude, beliefs, and so on and so forth. This is where we have to help our students to understand that when we talk about education, it is not just about the acquisition of knowledge. So people would acquire the knowledge, but without the right skill, without the right attitude, that knowledge becomes meaningless. So in as much as you are trying hard to get a first class, it is also important that you add the other dimensions of education. In terms of your attitude, in terms of your skill, in terms of your value as a student. And you have always known my problem with some of them. I feel that the moment a student opens their mouth, the way he or she talks should be substantially different from somebody who has not had the opportunity to go through the education that the student has gone through. From the home, to the school, to the church, everywhere you go, there is a form of what? Education. People have not been privileged enough to experience this form of education. Yeah. And so in terms of expectation, I have higher expectations for my students when it comes to their values, their skills, their attitudes, their habits. Because I've realized that in this 21st century, knowledge alone is not enough.
At all.
In fact, the knowledge will not even send you anywhere. People may have the right attitude. They will do the work that you have, your first class, but you will not be able to what? To do. So in as much as you are here to receive education, it is important that you don't limit your discourse or your focus to just the acquisition of knowledge.
The grades
alone may not be enough.
Yeah.
Build the right attitude, build the right skill, develop proper human values, and wherever you find yourself, you will survive.
Yeah.
Having said that, it is now important for us to look at the types of education that we have. We spent so much time on the meaning of education, and I'm sure by this time our learners are abreast with the fact that education leads to the acquisition of knowledge, skill, value, attitude, and habit. We have three types of education. Miss Miriam, can you walk us through? Take one, define it, explain it to us very well, then you give us some characteristics that will help us to know this is this type of education. This is how it differs significantly from this one. Then we can now do the juxtaposing ourselves.
Okay. And so, yes, we've said much. We earlier on made mention of the fact that schooling is just an aspect of education. And so, usually, a larger extent, we can see schooling as what our learners are going through now, as the formal type of education, where we have students, we have instructors. This form of education usually takes place in well-planned and organized institutions. It makes use of the syllabus and other things. And so, simply put, the formal education is this type of education that usually takes place in schools. So from KG, JHS, SHS, university, polytechnics, or technical universities, amongst others. So this is the form of education that we receive from there. This formal type that students or learners are supposed to be formal at every point in time in terms of being in the classroom, at assembly or social gatherings. We have an instructor, there's a curriculum that they interact with, and at the end of the day, an evaluation is conducted on that. So you realize that everything is planned in a systematic way as far as the formal education is concerned. Directly opposite that is the informal education. This informal one, usually what society or the morals, the values that are being imparted amongst us as one goes about his or her normal duties in the environment or in the society, in the community. So ways of dressing, talking, I mean, that is unstructured. It can take place anywhere, anyhow. It can take place at church. It can even take place in school, except that it is not planned at that point. And so, like I was saying, values in society, morals, all these things are things that happen at various forms. And in one way or the other, we learn from there. You can learn from your the chief's palace. You can learn. So whatever you learn, whatever you interact with in the environment at any point in time, you receive some form of education from there. Now, the non-formal one has, it tries to create a balance. So you could have aspects of the formal education and then aspects of the informal education, all embedded in the non-formal, yeah. And so they are semi-structured. Usually in such types of education, we could have let's say an instructor and then learners, so a group of 10, and usually it doesn't last for a long time, just a shorter period. And so we have people who are learning how to trade, how to prepare liquid soap, learning how to drive, driving schools and all this, these artisans. Now these are other forms of education where learners could attend and then receive some form of education from there. They also take place, like I've already said, in semi-structured institutions or organizations. They do not usually last for a long time. One could go there, acquire some knowledge, and then come back to live a meaningful life in the society.
Good.
So that is something brief.
That is something brief, and so I'll add a few of the characteristics. Mm. And here, let me reiterate that this is Radio Windy Bay 98.3. If you have just joined us this evening, we are discussing the school curriculum, social change, and national development. Specifically, we are talking about the types of education. We started by looking at the etymology of the word education, where we said that education comes from the Latin word educere, which means to lead out, or educare, which means to form or to train. We made it clear to our dear listeners that when we talk about education, it is not just about schooling, but rather it encompasses the acquisition of knowledge, skills, values, attitudes, and habits just for the sake of the very society that we are coming from. And so at this juncture, like I promised my listeners, we will activate the phone lines 0503-923-1585, 0503-923-1588, 0332-320201. We will continue with the discussion whilst we await your phone calls. You can phone in with your questions, your comments, your suggestions, or you can equally text or WhatsApp through 0503-923-1588. And so when we were talking about formal education, I was listening. One thing that we have to make it clear to our listeners is that in formal education, there is a well-defined and systematic curriculum. In formal education, assuming you are a teacher and you find yourself there, you cannot say that, okay, me, it is 2, but I don't want to close the school. I want to teach till it's 8 p.m. Nobody has recruited you to do that, because in formal education, it follows a specifically defined curriculum and a system.
Yeah.
Again, formal education is limited to a specific period of time. And so if you are taking the university, for example, first degree is supposed to be 4 years, maximum 5 years. You can't come here and spend 10 years that, oh, I feel like paying the school fees and staying. No, formal education is always limited to a specific period of time. It is always planned with a particular end in view. In formal education, we don't just do anything haphazardly. Everything is planned. And when we are planning, there is an end. So what kind of a person do we want to train within the 4 years in UEW?
Yeah.
And so when you pick the mission and the vision statement, it is clearly spelled out the kind of individual that this great institution seeks to churn out after the 4 years. Again, it is given by specially qualified teachers. In formal education, you cannot just come from your house and say, I'm tired of being a student, me too, I want to lecture.
No.
Every individual that you meet on campus here is a qualified personnel, irrespective of the size,
the age,
and the gender.
Yeah,
the person is qualified to be here. It includes activities outside the classroom. Our listeners have to understand that formal education is not always limited to the classroom. There are times that it goes beyond the classroom. And so when you take your students to field trip or excursion, though it is part of the school curriculum, it is taking place outside the frontiers of the school. Meanwhile, it is part of the formal education. Formal education observes strict discipline. In terms of discipline, we have to understand that
it's not about caning,
but formal education observes strict. That is why even as teachers, we can't do what we want. As a student, you can't do what you want. The moment you are admitted, you are given students' handbook. I'm sure most of our listeners have not gone through to see what is in the handbook. I'll urge you to take your time and read. Because as far as your stay on this campus is concerned, it is the handbook that will regulate what you have to do and what you don't have to do. Then we look at informal, where we said that it is incidental and spontaneous. It can happen anywhere, anyhow, anytime, irrespective. So you are going to the market with your mother. You never knew that your mother would beat you on the market before you get back to the house. As soon as you get to the market and you are looking at something, you are just gazing at one particular direction. Before you realize you are crying, there has been an education. When you are walking, be careful of what you have to look at and what you don't have to look at. If not, a car will knock you down. So as far as informal education is concerned, we have to know that nobody would come and arrange chairs to teach you. But it is the totality of the experience that you are going to gather in your life. It happens. And that is why you said, even within formal, there can be an aspect of what? Informal. Informal education is not pre-planned. Unlike the formal education where we said there is a defined and systematic curriculum, in terms of informal education, there is no defined and systematic curriculum. Everything can occur at any point in time. It is not imparted by any specialized agency. Unlike formal education where we said the person has to go to school to have acquire the skill of teaching before the person qualifies to teach. In informal education, you don't need qualification. Life itself is the best teacher.
It's a teacher on its own.
Yes. So there is no prescribed timetable or curriculum. And lastly, it may be positive or negative. So the way sometimes we dress, the way we talk and all that, most of these behaviors are acquired through informal education. And that is why we are saying that it doesn't necessarily have to be positive, like formal education, where everything is planned and guided, and for that matter, it can be positive. In informal, it can be both negative and positive. Lastly, we have the non-formal, of which you spoke about it. It is that organized systematic educational activity carried outside the framework of the formal system to provide selected types of learning to particular subgroups in the population. So it is that type of education that is always provided for selected people within a larger group. It can be adult as well as what? Children.
Children.
And so we come from villages. If IREPIX and the district veterinary officer decides to organize a short training for all pig farmers in the village, then of course we are talking about non-formal education.
Sure.
It is select. If you are not a pig farmer, you don't qualify to be there.
Yeah.
We should also bear in mind that you can't give exams in non-formal education. At least they will engage in hands-on activities and all that, but the type of examination that we have in the formal system cannot occur then,
yeah,
because it does not, it is not compulsory, first of all.
Yeah.
I may be a pig farmer, but I will not attend the meeting.
But you'll be doing well in your pig farming.
That's all. So that is what we have to understand. It does not lead to certification. And here our listeners have to understand that the kind of certification that we are talking about means that you cannot say because you have attended a pig farming session, you are applying to come and read BSc Agriculture in Winneba.
Or probably you are applying to the Ministry of Food and Agriculture.
With your certificate.
Your certificate.
No, it is just something to show that, oh, you participated in this very education. It doesn't guarantee that the moment you go and say, I've learned liquid soap. Okay, so which agency taught you? They say, oh, they organized it in our church and I was a member.
So I'm going to work at Food and Drugs Board.
No. That is the meaning. And so it is not compulsory, like I said, because if you want to compare it to formal education, especially in the era that we have F-cube, where we are thinking that every child of school going age must be in school, in non-formal education it is not
compulsory.
Sunday school is not compulsory.
Sure.
You can go today, next week. Even when you go, the correction that they will give you, you get to the roadside, you can buy granite and
go.
And go. It is not compulsory. It takes a place outside the realm of formal education. So it is not within formal education. However, it is conscious and it is deliberate.
Sure.
It is very conscious and it is deliberate. People sit down to plan. It doesn't happen anyhow like non-formal education. And so like this pig farming example I gave you, you have to plan how many people are coming, who is going to facilitate it, how would our people benefit, what kind of material do they need to work with. All these are things that go into the planning of non-formal education.
Sure. And it is just like hairdressing and carpentry or seamstress tailoring.
Good.
All these things, they are planned, conscious effort, they are planned. Though people go there, at the end of the day, they also claim to write some exams, which is practical, like you said. So it's practical. And even if you do that and you let's assume you fail, it doesn't prevent you from working.
Yes.
Because
yes,
you already have.
Yes.
Compared to the former one, where you may have to get a good distance before you receive your certificate.
All right. So listeners, we are still on air. This is Radio Windy Bay 98.3. This evening, we are talking about the types of education. It is important for us to understand the types of education so that next week when we meet, we will then try as much as possible to situate the whole idea of curriculum within educational context and to see how it will play out.
Right.
And so that is what I have been doing with my colleague in the studios. We just explained that education is not just about schooling. Don't say that the two words are synonymous. They are not. We mentioned the three types of education where we talked about formal, informal, and then non-formal. Our studios line is still active. 0503-923158, 0332-320201. The WhatsApp and the text line, 0503-923158. Let us all understand. Yes, we have a caller on the line. Hello, good evening. Please lower the volume of your radio set.
Okay. Please, my name is Evatoso.
Move away from the radio, please.
Okay. Is the line okay?
Yes, it's fine now. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Okay. Please, I want to ask, in what way can education become negative?
In what way can education...
Education becomes negative.
Negative.
As you were saying. Yeah.
All right. That's fine. Miss Miriam has taken it. She will answer as we go on. And so let me wrap up and then Miss Miriam can take this question and then we look at how it will go. We have another caller. Hello, good evening. Please, before you call, kindly move away from your radio set.
Good evening, I'm Jenny from Integrated Home Economics.
Yeah, Integrated Home Economics. You said the name is?
Jennifer Wushansa.
All right, Jennifer, please let's hear you.
Please, I didn't get the definition for education. Can you please repeat it for me?
You didn't get?
The first definition for education.
The first definition. All right, that's fine. I'll make sure I repeat it. Thank you very much for calling.
You're welcome.
All right, so we will wrap up and then we will now try as much as possible to answer your questions. And so as far as non-formal education is concerned, we have to understand that it is always organized for a homogeneous group of people. Mm. People who share the same characteristics. And so with the example that I gave, I said pig farmers. All those who have that character. Mm. Sunday school. Only those who find themselves. And so you find yourself even within denominations where the moment you get to a certain stage, you are promoted from Sunday school to another because...
Youth service.
Yes.
From Sunday school.
Then we have... One thing that we have to know that it is always serving the need of the identified group for a specific reason. Why would we group only children to teach them in the church? We don't want the children to go astray. Why would we want to give training to pig farmers so that they can enhance their practice on the field that they have chosen? And so as far as non-formal education, there is always a reason behind it. Thank you very much. I'll hand over to Miss Miriam Oga as she tries to answer the first question whilst I talk about the second one.
Okay,
that
so our dear student said he wants to find out in what way can education be negative. And so like we rightly said from the beginning, education can take place not only in school, at home, everywhere we find ourselves. So when this kind of education you receive is something that is not sanctioned by the society, then it becomes negative. I hope our dear listener, where it is something that is not sanctioned by the society, it becomes negative. So in your family, in your culture, you're not supposed to do A, B, C, D, and you find yourself doing it. It means that whatever interaction that you have had from peers or other people in the society, which occasioned you to behave in this particular way that the society frowns upon, it means you have received, or that type of education you have received is negative. Yeah.
All right, thank you. The next thing that Jennifer asked was, what was the first definition of education that I gave? And that was the definition by Agawa, 1995. Mm-hmm. And he says, education is what each generation purposively passes on to those who are to be their successors in order to prepare them to deal with one another and their surroundings purposively. Education is what each generation purposefully passes on to those who are to be their successors in order to prepare them to deal with one another and their surroundings purposively. And here we try to explain and even give relevant examples so that it will help you to understand what we are talking about. Miss Miriam, if you have anything you can add on whilst we wait other phone calls that may come up.
Okay, so I think we have delved much into the concept of education. And so we're still on it. We're still on it. We have already said
everything that there is to say. Waiting for your questions.
At least for their level, so that we don't scare them with the course, because they have some existing predisposition concerning the course. But at least for now, they're supposed to know that education can take place anywhere, anyhow, and at the same place. They should be very conscious of things they learn, in as much as they've come here. The tuition or the teaching that we are giving them on radio, on the V-class, and then the face-to-face interaction, it is just an aspect. They are going to have several forms of education from their peers as they walk from lecture hall to lecture hall, as they sit in the various shuttles, as they even come meet at the market, at the library, as they sit and learn on their own. They are going to receive other forms of education from their peers and others. So they should be very conscious of themselves, that so that at the end of the day, it won't be said of them that when they attended UEW, that is why they are behaving in that particular way. Yeah. Number of text messages from our listeners and viewers. One is, please say, I'm Crunchy Kinsman, political science level 100. I want to ask which type of education will seminars, workshops, and symposia fall within. Thank you. Okay, Crunchy Kinsman, you want to know of political science level 100. You want to find out where to place seminars, workshops, symposia under the three types of education. So, yes, these ones can fall under non-formal education and then the formal aspect of education. So, as part of the formal education we're giving you here in UEW, there may be instances where workshops will be organized for you to augment the face-to-face interaction, to augment the radio lecture, amongst others. So, it can fall over there. At the same time, this same seminars, workshops you asking can fall under non-formal education. So a group of people, let's say hairdressers or tailors, they may decide to, their leadership may decide to organize a seminar, a workshop, just to keep their members updated on new fashion styles that are trending. And so they may do this in the form of workshop and others. So workshop, seminars, they can be classified under both formal education and then non-formal education. We also have another text from Seidu. So please, I am Seidu Isaka. Is it Mufatao from Political Science? Please, my question is that, can the negative aspect copied in school be classified under the benefits of education? Negative aspect. So Isaka, can you classify something that is negative at the same time being positive? It's like you consider something to be negative and you want to see it as positive. So it is not quite clear over there. Once the thing is negative, that is it. If we want to throw further light on this, no school has deliberate plans to inculcate negative things into or amongst its learners. KG, primary, JHS, university, nursing training, none of these schools or none of these institutions has deliberately put in place to inculcate negative things into its learners. It is, as you said, these types of education, they are not mutually exclusive. That is why in our discussion, we made it clear that in as much as you're receiving formal education, where we come to the lecture hall to teach you, where we meet on the V class, as we are on radio now, we are giving you some form of formal education. But you shouldn't forget that your existence on campus is not dependent, the form of education you are receiving, though you are in the university, it doesn't mean that you may not learn other things that are not deliberately planned and taught by lecturers. Of course, you will learn from your colleagues. You go to the library, as you're in the shuttle, through communication, you're going to learn certain things. So if those things you learn at school is negative, it doesn't mean that the kind of training that UEW is giving is negative. So I beg to differ, or we beg to differ. I don't know whether my colleague has something to say. The fact that you came here and you end up being a drunkard doesn't mean that the institution trained you to be a drunkard, or doesn't mean that it is in the mission and vision statement of UEW to train people to become drunkards.
Thank you very much. And so we are about running up. It's almost 6:30. This evening we talking about types of education under the course EDC 111, the school curriculum, social change and national development. Mm-hmm. And we looked at the definition of education, where we said that as people, we have to reorient our mindset, thinking that education is the same as schooling. And for that matter, thinking school is about the acquisition of knowledge. Hello.
How are you, sir?
Yeah, good evening.
Yeah, good evening, sir. I'm Nketia Destiny from Correct Person.
Nketia
Destiny from Correct Person.
All right.
My friend. But, sir, like what you are talking about, you are talking about education. And what I mean is that education is the basis of human learning. That with knowledge is required for cognitive and skill development.
Yeah.
But I want to know the root, the origin, or the etymology of the word literate and illiterate. Because as Aga was saying that education is from the day you born and to the day you die. Now I say that some people do not attend school, we refer to them as illiterate.
Good. And so the illiteracy we mentioned, in some books you may not see illiteracy, but you say lettered. Such people
illiteracy
are not
unlettered.
Yes. Such people may not have gone through the A, B, C, D that you have done. Mm. It doesn't mean they are illiterate.
Yeah.
But we want to see such people as people who have not gone through the kind of education that we have gone through.
Which is the schooling.
Which is the schooling aspect. And so for education, we should have it straight at the back of our minds that education is not just about buying trunk or chop box and going to Mfantepim.
So I think the learner probably, the caller probably joined us late. You see, the fact that you are able to read and write in the L2 doesn't make you an educated person, well-educated person. So if somebody doesn't know how to read and write, then you tend to see the person as uneducated. That is their schooling. So you are in school. The person is not in school. But this person is also receiving other forms of education in the society. So education is not about your ability to read and write the L2.
All right. But, of course, we have to understand him. We live in a society where, irrespective of your attitude, how you live your life, the moment you are able to speak English, the society sees you with a different lens. So when you get to the hospital, for example, and you are speaking English with the doctor, it affects the kind of outlook that the doctor will have about you. And so that is where the confusion comes from. But we've tried as much as possible to clarify that. Let us get it. Education is not just about coming to school.
Mm.
It is about the total development of the learner. So if you are here and you have just developed an aspect of you, then I'll be right to say that you are illiterate when it comes to the other dimensions.
Mm.
Because you may not have those dimensions or those domains that we normally talk about.
Okay.
And so we were about running up this discussion. We're still live on Radio Windy B 98.3. This evening, we've been talking about the types of education in the course EDCR 111, the school curriculum, social change and national development. We looked at education in its etymological form, where we said it comes from the word educere or educe, which means to lead out, to form, or to train, respectively. We also said that basically there are three types of education: formal, informal, and non-formal. Having said this, we draw the curtains down on this evening's lecture. God willing, next week, we will come back and continue the discussion. And possibly the other subsequent weeks, we would be meeting 5:30 to 7 p.m. Unfortunately, the phone calls are not coming. And for that matter, we just have to be grateful to our listeners for joining us this evening. I'm sure most students are not aware that we've started a radio lecture series. We will plead with you to inform other colleagues, because whatever it is that we teach on the radio, we will not repeat it in the classroom.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm here this evening with my colleague
Miriam Oga
and myself, Stephen Kwachiapel. God willing, we meet next week. Have a blessed week.